Grace and peace to you, friends, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and good morning. My name is Brett Swanson, pastor of Wauwatosa Presbyterian Church, and we are very glad you are joining us this Sunday, July 26th. We have much to celebrate, including the commitment that we have had since the very beginning that all are indeed welcome to worship with us, no matter where you're coming to our services from, at home, abroad, who knows. We're glad that you're here. The body of Christ, as Paul says, is made up of many different parts, and we want to be complete and whole. And so your worshiping with us, your presence with us today helps achieve that. Thank you for joining us. And whether this is your first Sunday or you've been with us since this remote beginning, we are very glad that you are here. Now, we want to welcome all those who are worshiping with us by our worship, by our sermon, by phone system. You can call 414-253-8521 to hear an audio recording of this service in its entirety. That will be uploaded upon completion. You can worship with us from the comfort of your home for those who do not have access to the streaming capabilities needed for our online worship. Now, as I said, today is July 26th, and so we will welcome Sarah and Jim Rand back to the church for one farewell parade taking place at 9 a.m. today. So if it's between 9 and 10:30 a.m., get in the car and come on down. This is a no-touch, no-contact, remain in your vehicles, wear masks, socially distant parade and farewell. You'll have an opportunity to say a few words of love and comfort and farewell to Jim and Sarah. And they will do the same. You can enter our parking lot through the 80th Street entrance, and you'll exit out the clearly marked outlet into the road that takes you to the middle school. No gifts, please, and cards and notes and things will be accepted. I'm sure we'll see Jim and Sarah again soon, but for now, this will be our opportunity to say farewell and Godspeed to our beloved friends. Well, today we tackle the idea of God's plan. Last week it was an idea of doubt. This week it's when we are not so sure that all things are part of God's plan, or that God needs another angel, or that God must have had a reason for things like car wrecks and cancer and COVID. It's simply not true. Friends, let us worship God.
Let us pray. God of all life, do not darken your light to us. God of life, do not limit your joy in us. God of life, do not shut your doors to us. God of life, do not refuse your mercy. Eternity cannot hold you, nor can our little words catch the magnificence of your kindness. Yet, in the space of small hearts and in silence, you alone can repair us. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from Luke chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. At that very time, there were some present who were told about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will perish as they did, or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did."
Last week, in our exploration of the idea of doubt, we approach this sense of what we need to believe to be a Christian. We hear the story of doubting Thomas, and in doubt we saw that Thomas's expression of his doubt became a vehicle for his own faith. He models what I'd like to call good doubt for us. He shows that it's based in humility, and it's from humility that we will be transformed. He shows that certainty is a kind of idolatry. And to be so rock-solid, dogmatic, immobile prevents growth. But what I liked best about that Doubting Thomas story was that it shows that life doesn't happen in a vacuum, that faith doesn't happen in a vacuum either. A well-lived life and faith means encountering what we do not to believe to be true and figuring out that our faith is an exploration. Our faith is a long game. It's a lifetime journey. It's intended to be interactive because there's constantly a push-pull between what we've been told and what we encounter. And a lot of what we've been told about God and Christ and love and grace and certainly judgment and the big ticket capital letter Christian words and concepts sometimes can be subtly harmful and untrue. And that's where we're going this week. This week we're going to explore one of those subtle but deeply untrue and potentially harmful facets of our faith. It's that idea that everything that happens is part of God's plan, or that we say everything happens for a reason. The untruth of all part of God's plan is sometimes subtle. And I use untruth rather than just flat out lie, because I think lie intends a sense of deception. But that's rarely the case. You know, people will sometimes tell you that the earthquake that ravaged Haiti, which continues to be one of the poorest, one of the most destitute places on earth, that it makes sense that that earthquake was God somehow pulling the levers. And I don't believe that to be true. And I don't believe that people who say such things always mean what they say, that God somehow brought that earthquake to the shore of Haiti, intentionally. Famously, one TV blowhard would disagree with me, who said that the Haitian earthquake was God's doing, God's vengeance, for generations of voodoo being practiced on the island. Now that's different. This TV blowhard knew exactly what he was saying. But it's very easy to be confronted with some tragedy and heartbreak and pain and loss and suffering and the like, and offer what feels like truth, what feels like comfort, but in fact, it's one of these untruths. I don't think anybody goes out of their way to say something harmful when they encounter a hurricane or a tornado or a car wreck or a diagnosis or a death premature and says it was an act of God, or it must have been their time, or everything happens for a reason. How many of these have you heard? How many of these have you been told? And how many of these have you offered to others? I know I have. I know I've said that maybe this is part of God's plan. I know I've heard that this is God's will being done. I've certainly heard before that this is some part of God's mysterious ways, or that God must have had a purpose. My least favorite one. You'd hear it at a funeral. God must have needed another angel. I heard that at the funeral of a teenager who I buried in Punxsutawney at my last church. She was on a convertible ride with friends. Her grandmother's old car, a PT Cruiser convertible, my mom's got one just like it. They were out on a country road and there was no shortage of them out in Punxsy. Driving maybe fast, I don't know. But they slipped and she was thrown out of the car. Just 16, 17, teenager. She was kind, she was beautiful, she was compassionate and caring and silly. She wanted to be a nurse in order to help other people. I imagine she's exactly the kind of angel that God would want, but she died horribly and painfully. And the family was committed to having the casket open on the service so that her friends and loved ones could see her one last time, and she was unrecognizable. And there in the funeral home, not a space was left unoccupied by one of the mourners, and there were tears, and there were wailing, and there was silence, and just bewilderment and heartbreak. And the question that was on everybody's lips was simply just, why? Why did she have to die? Was it her fault? Was it the driver's? She wasn't driving. Was it the condition of the road? Was it the car? Was there something else we could point to that we could blame it on? Some wanted a measure of why. A question trying to seek comfort by invoking God and hoping that everything was part of God's plan. Is everything part of God's plan? Is the death of a teenager out on a country road part of God's plan? is if the Brewers win part of God's plan? Shooting and hurricanes, is that part of God's plan? What if I forget my wife's birthday? Was that God's will being done? The foundation is that God is responsible for everything, for everyone's actions. That's where we get this language, this sense of determinism or maybe even fatalism. But do you believe that to be true? There's a great appeal in that sense of a big, big God, and it's all part of God's plan, a big God who manages every moment of every life and every wind that blows or doesn't has that this appeal there, that it offers uncertainty in the uncertain and anxious world we live in. It's comforting to have some big God that's in control, but again, that's a sense of theological determinism, that all things happen because God determined they would. In the Old Testament, we read about droughts during the time of the prophet Elijah. We hear of leprosy and the general name, and Jesus even says that aren't two sparrows sold for a small coin, but not one of them will fall without God knowing? There is some rationale in Scripture for such this determinist way of thinking and reading, but I want you to consider that that drought in the time of Elijah was not intended to teach us about weather or soil erosion, and that the leprosy with general Nahum was not intended to teach us about the facets of how God works through dermatology and sparrows and not knowing one falling without, and not one falling without God knowing. It's sense that God's knowledge is something that is different from God's commanding that it happens. Because this is what Jesus seems to be talking about in this small little story about this tower that falls in the city of Siloam. It's an accident. Towers fall. 18 die. And Jesus sees this as a tragedy. Jesus sees this as being awful. It would be easy for him to turn this into a lesson because crowds and others, they want to talk about judgment, that what did these 18 do to deserve this? But Jesus doesn't take the bait because God doesn't knock down that tower. God didn't need 18 angels that day. God didn't call their number because it was their time. God did not guide the hands of a shoddy work so that many would die so as to inspire others to take up better construction practices. But it's so easy to go there in hopes of making sense of things. But God does not commodify, and that's a word I want to leave you with today. God does not commodify human life to take something sacred and intrinsically good and use it cheaply. It's dangerous theology at work to think that God's plan, that God needs another angel, because that's untrue about God. God does not take you or my life sacred and turn it cheap in order to make a point or offer some sort of silver lining life lesson. God does not sell off those 18 souls, those 18 children of God, so that a lesson could be learned. That's not the way that God sees life. Because God calls us partners. God calls us beloved. We are fearfully, we are wonderfully made. We are called to work hand in hand with Christ and the Spirit in love. We are not pawns to move around on some board. We're not fodder for someone else's life lessons. Our lives are not intended to purely be silver linings so we have one to grow on. No. God does not treat your life or my life as expendable. And so when that pretty and smart and compassionate and loving teenager died on that backcountry road in Punxsutawney, I'll tell you that the streets of heaven were unnaturally crowded that day. And when that beloved daughter and sister and granddaughter and friend saw God face to face for the first time, I believe there were tears in the eyes of the Almighty. Because certainly no one wanted that girl to die. No one chose it. Especially God. I heard someone say that they don't believe in a God who could possibly, who could intentionally, purposefully take this beautiful, smart, compassionate, loving teenager's life and cause her family so much pain. And as the pastor who officiated that funeral, they came up to me and asked me about that kind of God, and I looked them straight in the eye and said, well, I don't believe in that kind of God either. So So who is the God that I believe in? You know, we've talked about the God we do not believe in. The one that takes life cheaply, the one that causes human sorrow in order to satisfy a need or to stick to a plan. But I want to talk about the God that I believe in. The one that does not choose cancer or Alzheimer's or HIV and AIDS or COVID for some and not for others and use that somehow as a tool to bring about something else. I believe in a God that does not send hurricanes and floods and earthquakes to punish people. I believe in a God that never needs another angel so as to take one from us. I believe in a God whose heart breaks when bullets fly and when the elderly are forgotten. I believe in a God whose heart breaks when cancer ravages bodies. I believe in a God whose heart breaks when hatred and racism take hold in a life. God does not depend on human suffering to achieve God's purposes. God seeks to give us the will and the opportunity to work alongside God. You do not have to believe in God's plan to be a Christian. In fact, your faith will be stronger if you see yourself not subject to some sort of Almighty's whims, but instead as a free partner whom God desires to work in and through and with. There's a saying on the internet, and I'll leave you with this. It goes, "It'd be like that sometimes." It's true, it just be like that sometimes. Some things happen. It's the way life goes. But God didn't will it to be done. What does God will for us? Life. And life to the fullest. And thanks be to God for that. Amen. Will you pray with me? Loving and faithful God, equip our hearts to enter into a world convinced that the easy answer, the available answer, has enough appeal to drown out depth and breadth, especially when found in faith. Exercise the idolatry out of us, O Lord, so convinced that we can find you in lowest common denominators and quick little answers and in trite little words. Forgive us, O Lord, whenever we seek to offer comfort and instead bring pain. Forgive us when we ascribe to you the failings of our own hearts and minds. Forgive us, so quick to let us off the hook, ourselves off the hook, that we throw you under the proverbial bus. There are those among us, O Lord, who need your love and care. This community is hurting, O Lord. We are weary. And so give us a good word, some bit of truth, some willingness to participate and live into a mystery of your commitment to loving and not a desire for some anything else. We pray, O Lord, for those who are angry. We pray, O Lord, for those who are hurt. We pray, O Lord, for those whose hurt has led them to anger, whose grief is inconsolable, whose frustration is inexhaustible. We pray for those who want something that they cannot have. We pray for those who have something that they don't want. We pray for those who are sick and who will be. We pray for those who shun the responsibility of that truth and pass it on as if somehow this is your will. Forgive us, O Lord. Equip us to be partners in life, in truth, in community, and relationship. We pray for the state of our nation and for its leaders. We pray for racial animosity and hatred in this world and in this country. We pray for those who are on the front lines of this pandemic. We pray for those we do not know and those we do. We pray for those on our prayer list and those prayers that have come to us through our prayer box. We name them before you now.
As a community, we pray for those experiencing life's transitions, residents of nursing care facilities, those affected by illness, our students, medical professionals, and the members of Friends of this congregation, including Amy and Maggie, Betty Brown, Jay Costello, Bob DeGroote, Virginia Doherty, Ellen Ferguson, Norma Fernhaber, John Freed, Tony Katsun and family, Pauline Kilhefner, Jean Koch, Sharon Polakowski's parents, Dave and Mary Roberts, Faith Rhodes, the Tompkins family, and Roy Wetter. We also pray for the members of Narcotics Anonymous and other support groups who are unable to meet in person during this time, and for those incarcerated, and for the prayers submitted through our community's prayer box.
Let us pray using the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, as we conclude our service today and our time together, I want to share with you a prayer that comes out of the Methodist tradition, written long ago by John Wesley, the founder of Methodism as we know it. It's called the Covenant Prayer, and I think it speaks beautifully to this idea that we are to be present and working alongside God in the unfolding of God's greater plan and love and justice out into the world. It's called the Covenant Prayer, and I invite you as our benediction to pray with me once more. I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt, rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed by thee or laid aside for thee, exalted for thee or brought low for thee. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine. So be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Friends, may the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit and the example of Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, be with you now and always, friends. Go in God's peace.